It's the SDG Podcast. Before we get started, you can check us out on the web at solutiondesign.com/podcast or find us on all the social medias, LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Solution Design Group.
Welcome to the SDG Podcast. I'm here today with Chad Juttner and Ian Remembera. Hi, and I'm Peter Lawrence. And today we're going to be talking about the future of transportation and our ideas about it and our experiences with current future and future. So, Ian, you kind of started us off on this topic, talking about the future of, are we all going to be driving electric cars in the future?
That seems to be where things are headed, especially with the environmental goal right now of zero emissions. So we're seeing a lot of companies and countries trying to head towards their, electric vehicles just because of environmental concerns. So I think that's where the future is headed. In terms of time frame, can't really maybe pinpoint to how long it's going to take. I think it's going to be a little bit of a challenge just because right now, I'm guessing maybe from numbers, probably 90 or 95% of the world is using fossil fuels for not only cars, but also planes and stuff. So I think it's going to take a really long time. But I think eventually that's where we'd see ourselves. Maybe not in our lifetime, but I can see a future where it will be maybe 90 or even more percent electric.
So 100 years from the first electric cars, maybe 100 years from now until the all electric cars.
Yeah. Something like that for sure. Yeah.
I know we were talking a little bit about where are our flying cars, right?
Yeah.
And I mean, I thought the future, well, there's a couple of futures, right? There's flying cars, there's Jetsons, there's other kinds of things like that. Where are we going with that, Chad? Do you think we're going to have flying cars ever?
I don't think so. I think they exist. We've always seen, you've seen the demos of these things already, right? Like,
right.
I don't know. I used to read a lot of Wired magazine, and they'd always show, like, when somebody came up with some new idea for a flying car, it would be news. And then you just think about the impracticality of parking something like that in a city, right? Like, can you imagine? Like,
well, but they had fold up wings now, right?
Mm-hmm. They do have fold up wings. I can barely get out of ramp B when I go to a Twins game in a regular car in a city designed for that. I can't imagine the logistics of everybody having a flying car in the future. I think the ability to own, a small personal aircraft is going to be more of a thing, maybe. And actually, it's funny, my next door neighbor has, he does this thing called a propelled parachute. So yeah. Like in his garage right now, he's got a little
microplane, ultralight.
Little microplane, yeah. And it's basically just a roll cage with a giant fan and a massive parachute that can that deploys, and a fan shoots the and it looks like a blast. It looks like that guy. Remember the Road Warrior, right? The Mad Max movie, the second one.
Yep.
That dude in the little helicopter with basically just a roll cage and a little. It's basically that. Looks really cool. But it's
a little safer looking, right?
He's told me about a couple of close calls. I don't know that it's necessarily safer. You need a.
Is it power lines that are the close call? What do you have close calls with?
Trees. Like when he's landing. Yeah, it's not a precise instrument, right? Like it is an approximation of fly where you're like, you don't have precise control over where you're going. I guess I've never gone up with him. I've only seen the videos that he sends, and
so he's not taking off from your street and shooting up into the air.
No, he does like soccer fields. There's a soccer field up in Rogers that he takes off from, or something like that. He won't go right up our street and try to catch you. I think legally you can. I think he's got, I'm probably butchering this, but he's got like a you have to get a pilot's license, but there's a special license for experimental aircraft, and that's
crazy, crazy person pilot license, right?
Yeah, that's technically what that is. But I don't know, man. I mean, gosh, flying cars, probably not.
Ian, what do you think?
Well, when I hear about flying cars, one thing we have to realize is this concept has been here for quite some time. Yeah. I was doing some research, and Well, the first flying car was debuted in New York, 1917. So that's over 100 years ago. And the first certified flying car was in 1950. So we're talking about over 74 years ago. So this is definitely a concept that has been there for quite some time. I think humanity has this dream of, you know, being able to, hey, I'm stuck in traffic. Let me just press a button and I'm out of here type of thing,
up,
right?
Up in the air, right?
Yeah. And I think, like I said, for most of us, as this for me, I speak for myself, growing up and seeing like the Flintstones, I'm like, oh, probably sometime in the future, that's how it's going to be. So the big question that rises up is, why aren't we seeing these flying cars, right? Clearly, from a technological standpoint, it's something that has been achievable. But why aren't we able to see, you know, the dreams that we had when we were kids, right? So first of all, from an engineering perspective, designing a car that can drive on the road and fly at the same time is a little bit of a technological challenge, right?
Right.
Why is that? The goals are different. You know, the goals are different. Driving on the road, you know, things like braking or maybe the weight of the car versus flying is a different goal of, you know, it got to be lighter, the aerodynamics and stuff like that. So for engineers, that can be a little bit of a challenge because you're trying to shoot two birds with one stone. That can be a little hard, right?
So you get the worst of both worlds, right?
Exactly. But yeah, jumping off that, what has been the biggest holdback? It's just rules and regulation, right? They haven't found a systematic way to kind of like have this out there and everybody using it. There's a lot of concerns. Of course, there's safety. For example, you know, if you're driving in your car and your engine breaks down, it's easy to pull on the side of the road and maybe call a mechanic.
Yeah.
If your car is up there and the engine breaks down, you know that's going to be a different story, right? So
hopefully you coast and land.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, you can see.
It's funny. I used to live a lot of them. I think. Crystal. Go ahead.
Yeah, a lot of them are legitimate concerns. So in terms of regulations on how, you know, how these things going to operate, are people going to be safe? The infrastructure to deal with this, you know, this sort of thing. I think that's where there's a lot of holdback, and that introduces the new concept that thing Chad was talking about earlier, which is the EVOS, you know, electric vertical takeoff and landing, right? Which is kind of like, well, it's pretty much a bigger drone, right? And maybe
big
we can
drone,
dig that into
deep,
but I think that's the reason why we're not seeing quote unquote electric cars flying all over the space. It's something that there's a little bit of concerns, and you know, the world we live in today, there's some rules and regulations need to be passed before such massive changes can be made.
Jed, what were you going to say about getting pulled over in Crystal? No, wait. You used to live near Crystal Airport?
I did. I used to live near the Crystal Airport, and the Crystal Airport was one of the draws to the Crystal Airport was it was a mechanics hub for helicopters.
Oh, nice.
And so when you talk about like these things breaking, I lived right next to where the field was up the road, and you would hear these helicopters go up, right? And the guys just take them up and bring them right back down. But you can tell like, oh, that doesn't sound right. Like, I don't know anything about helicopters, but I know it's not supposed to sound like that.
Did you see any landings on the roadway from airplanes or anything like that?
No, it was all nothing super strange, but it was you did hear some interesting sounds and noises that I don't think you hear at other airports.
No, Minneapolis never sounds like that, as far as I can tell.
Yeah. Other modes of transportation. So we were talking about electric cars a lot, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you guys have driven a Tesla or Rivian or one of these things, right?
I have not. Yeah. I have been avoiding them thus far because I don't want to fall in love and then have to go buy one. That's my fear.
Well, I've got great news for you, man. You won't. you might. I don't know. I rented a Tesla. Oh gosh, this is a few years ago. Took my daughter to California, and I saw that it was an option. So I'm like, oh, cool. I'll rent the Tesla.
Right.
So we got the whatever the full size. And initially, it is. You will fall in love with it. It is really cool. Right. Like.
Yeah.
I was the instant acceleration, the tech is kind of neat a little bit. But what I found in California is as an option for a rental. I mean, this wouldn't have been a problem if I owned it. But as a rental, like I stayed at a hotel that didn't have a charging station outside. After, I don't know, 100 hours or something, I'm like, oh, we should probably find one. But we're in California, right? These things are obviously everywhere.
Right.
And it's kind of true. They are. The charging stations are kind of everywhere. But there are so many people in California that have this that I had to wait. I don't think there was a single time where I didn't wait less than an hour for a charging station in California, a place that has the infrastructure for this.
So you did nothing except wait to go fill up your car with electricity, right?
The couple of places that we saw them, one of them was in a Whole Foods parking lot. That was one. There's other Tesla specific stations here and there. And the app the car actually tells you.
Tells you where the superchargers are, right?
Yeah, go here. But you're in California and those folks aren't necessarily the most polite. So like, I can't leave my car, you know, and be like, I'm sure this person will know that I was here first and I can go. No, you have to literally had to wait, which is a horrible way to spend a vacation. So, if you're going to rent one, make sure your hotel has a charging station. If you don't,
that's the same problem if you own a Tesla, right? You have to find a hotel with a charging station.
I mean, if you're traveling, if you're doing a road trip in it, yes.
Right.
But like, that's what I'm saying. Like, if I owned one and I had one in my garage and I didn't have to worry, I mean, I don't usually drive more than 200 miles a day. So,
right. You know,
my range covers me. But as a rental option, boy, it was not great. I didn't love it. I love the car. I love most of the car. The radar, you know, the surrounding stuff was kind of cool.
Yeah.
It showed you the cars all over you. The lane assist at the time, that was the first car that I had that had that kind of like lane assist stuff.
Keeps you in the lane. Yeah.
Yeah. Kind of cool. But other parts, I don't know, man.
You didn't come home and buy a Tesla right away.
No, after the couple hours, then it's just a car. Right.
Right.
And it's not even it's not even a cool looking car. Right. It's not like a sports car or anything. It's got the performance of one, but it's just a sedan.
So it's not a Ferrari. It's a Ferrari engine wrapped in a Honda Civic.
It's like a Ferrari in a Camry, kind of.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it doesn't sound as cool. It's not, you know. So I don't know. I mean, I think electric and hybrid, yeah, that's, I think that train has left the station. The momentum is there. It's going to happen. And I think it's probably mostly fine if you own one and you have, you know, you can charge it at home. And then also if you're in an urban area, it's probably fine too, right? Because there's infrastructure around.
I mean, SDG has two charging stations outside their building, right?
We just got those, didn't we?
Yeah. And they seem used every single time I'm there, so.
Yeah, every time I've been there, I've seen at least a car or two being utilizing that resource.
Yeah, yeah. So yeah. Ian, you said you'd driven a Tesla?
Yeah, I've driven a Tesla before. My experience was different from Chad. I absolutely love the vehicle. The only thing that I did not enjoy, and you know, I'm kind of a car fanatic too. Like, I do like cars, is the roaring sound of the engine, right? I have a sports car, and that is one of the feels, right? The experience, you know, if I'm bored or anything, just hit the gas, kind of get the momentum, my adrenaline rush. I love that. Couldn't get that with the Tesla. You know, you can press, I can call it gas. Can you press the gas? I don't know what you say. Maybe
the accelerator.
And it's going to fly. It's going to fly, but you're not going to get the raw sound that you're looking for, especially for us, for car fanatics. So from that perspective, I was a little bit dissatisfied. I do like how it accelerates in terms of performance. It's very good from that perspective. And it has a lighter feel to it, you know. So in terms of the general feel of the car and, you know, its capabilities, I was really impressed. I'm thinking of also going electric myself. I was thinking of probably the next car I was going to buy. But I still feel like I'm still not done with the, you know,
still not done cars. Enjoying the cars, the motors.
Yeah, so I think I'm gonna do 5 more years of you know, fossil fuels before I go to electric stuff, maybe down the line. But yeah, my experience is good. I definitely think I'll get something like that, like a Tesla. My favorite model is Model X. Maybe not in the near future, but I know at some point for sure. So, but again, I think when Chad was talking about, I think there's some use cases like a road trip. I really wouldn't recommend taking an electric car for a road trip. I just feel that's a lot of problems that can come up to that, especially like what you talked about, charging ports and stuff like that. So I personally wouldn't do that. I think if it's for a use case where, let's say if you're living around, for example, Twin Cities area, you don't really commute as much, maybe to the office and back and maybe see a couple of friends, I think it's definitely a good use case. I'm not sure about vacation because I was definitely heading to Cali in July and I was thinking of renting one. So thank you, Chad, because I'm not going to do that. But I think for day-to-day, runs around, you know, town, I think that's applicable. But anything after that, I think we're over pushing it with the technology we have right now.
So it's a good commuter car. It's a great commuter car. It's an inexpensive.
Yeah.
Easy to maintain, not so many moving parts, not so many fluids.
You don't have to change the oil now, so that's good. Mm-hmm.
No.
You save yourself a good $100 every month. I mean, you know,
you gotta
take a car for oil change, whatever.
You got to pay that. Like, what is the battery life expectancy on these? Like a decade, right? So at some point, you have to replace all the batteries.
Well, and it's funny. I think that the battery life has really, I think the idea of the battery life has changed a little bit now that they've been in practice.
Yeah.
I know when I had a Prius, there was a 10-year warranty on the batteries. Well, I had my Prius 8 years. It wasn't even thinking about, you know, battery life at that point. It was doing just fine. So I wonder if Teslas aren't going to be kind of in the same, like, yes, eventually you'll have to replace the batteries, right? But there's also the case where you might not have to replace them as often as we've been led to believe.
That could be. One of the other, I think we're settled, right? Like electric cars, they're cool. If you own one and it's your primary, like, yes, you'll probably save a little bit of money. If you live in a city, you're probably in good shape. You probably don't really need to worry about like running out of juice.
Put some solar cells on your roof and you're driving for free.
Yeah. Yeah. Seriously. Rural communities, probably not as big of a thing. I wouldn't be as excited if I was rural. I mean, the infrastructure isn't there, at least in Minnesota. And I think it's kind of unfair to some of the dealerships. Now, if I'm remembering right, I think there's a law on the books that, you know, they want dealers to sell X number of electric cars, right?
That's right.
They don't discriminate, though, based on the dealer's location. So a dealer up in, you know, Red Lake has to still have that, you know, I've got to sell this many electric cars when there's not really even any infrastructure for it up there. I mean, there is. I think the Ojibwe are building it into like their, you know, there's a plan for that. But like, my goodness, I think some of the legislation and some of the ideas around this aren't quite fair considering the reality of what's actually available to folks. That said, I mean, what is it? 80% of the population of Minnesota lives within, I don't know, 100 miles of the Twin Cities. Is that?
Well, yeah. And not only that, but I mean, you have to live pretty rural to not be within the range of a modern electric car, right? Like 300 miles a day. That's a pretty long day for almost everybody. You know, that's 5 hours in your car.
60% of Minnesota residents live within. I had to look it up.
There we go.
Yeah.
Back check.
All right. So yeah, I mean, electric cars, cool. Infrastructure is still kind of coming. We'll get there.
Well, and you still have the line problem, right? You still have to sit in line and wait because you can't fill them as fast as, I mean, my Sam's Club here has probably 30 people waiting for gas on any given Saturday morning. And then they go through and there's a constant 30 people waiting. The line goes out of the club. It's so long.
But that's because Sam's Club gas is cheaper. I mean, I don't have to wait at Holiday or...
No, true. But I'm just saying that you can't service 30 people. Like, can a charging station service 30 people in an hour?
How long does it normally take to charge an electric car? Not the fast charging, like the regular ones we see out there at the charging ports.
I'm trying to remember. I think when I was out there, it was like a half hour. I don't remember.
Half hour on the supercharger would get you to 80%, something like that, right?
Yeah, that sounds about right.
And for me, I think that's, I guess, currently also part of an issue because if, let's say, I'm on vacation, right? Maybe a weekend vacation or something, and my time is limited, I don't want to plan for charging a car. You know what I'm saying? If, let's say, I'm staying at an Airbnb or hotel that doesn't have the infrastructure to charge my car while I'm sleeping, that means I have to take time out of my day because, you know, a gas station is a 5-minute thing. You full tank and you're out of there. 30 minutes, you really have to plan to wait those 30 minutes. That means it's part of your program. But to add on to that, I think I was reading an article that says that they're looking into, of course, in the future where the range of these electric cars is going to be more. So I think right now it's average probably 300 miles. They're thinking of probably 500 or even 1,000. Right. So that would be, I guess, sufficient. But again, it still comes down to, okay, if the range is more, does that mean we have to charge it more? You know, what's the issue with that? So, yeah, but I think in terms of that perspective, then it sounds more of a little bit of an inconvenience that I have to wait somewhere. Now, for example, like Chad, he said, not only did he have to charge the car for 30 minutes, I think he had to be there for an hour to wait to even get to the charging spot itself. So talking about on average, maybe an hour or 2 hours, that's taking too much time out of my day. You know, I'd rather just get a gas card, 5 minutes, I'm, you know, pump the gas. It's not even, instead of 5 minutes and I'm out of there and I'm a full tank.
Right.
So
right.
That's also something to consider.
So, and as technology changes, both battery charge speeds, I mean, I don't know, Ian, if you're old enough to remember, but Chad, you're certainly old enough to remember where it took a long time to charge a cell phone. You know, overnight was not even out, like 10 hours to charge your cell phone, just because that's what it take, right? Especially, well, if you had the big battery and everything, because you wanted to last the whole day and spend some time on it, now it takes an hour to charge your cell phone. And I think cars are going to probably be the same way. I know that they're working on, you know, supercapacitor technology too, which is the great thing about a capacitor is it charges very quickly, right? You just shoot a high voltage across it and it holds on to that voltage for quite a long time. The hard part is to slowly take the voltage off of the capacitor. And so smart people are working on it. What about some alternative fuels? Anybody thinking about hydrogen future cars? Or
in high school, my buddy had his mom had a minivan powered by natural gas.
Yeah,
that was weird.
So did they fill up at their house or did they have to go to the
Well, so his mom worked for Mini Gasco, so
okay, that made it easier.
somehow she just I never saw it get filled. All I knew is there's a big propane tank in the back,
yep,
filled with natural gas. And it smelled a little funny.
Okay.
Outside of that, hydrogen, other alternative fuels, I don't really know anything about most of that outside of ethanol.
They just really don't seem to be taking off like electric has.
Yeah.
I think the convenience factor, I have to go to Minnegasco or I have to go to this one. I mean, I don't know how many hydrogen fuel stations there are in Minnesota. I'm suspecting it's under 10, if not under zero, because they just don't sell those cars here. And so there's no infrastructure for it. And that's kind of been the problem with most of the alternative fuels is infrastructure. And that's the great thing about electricity is we use electricity all the time at our house, at our business, at everywhere. So a lot of that infrastructure is already there. However, we haven't been charging our cars 50 years to have that built up infrastructure in order to power all of that, right?
You know, I tell this every once in a while. I kind of remember as a kid what it was like to just drive around the city. And I've noticed, I mean, especially now I'm on my motorcycle a lot. When I drive around, I remember it smelling bad. Like the roads never smelled good. And the cars always had like crappy exhaust systems. There's even on, you know, warm days, you would see smoke and smog and junk coming in cars. And you just kind of realize like that's a thing that just kind of slowly went away. Right. And I think that's, you know, stricter emissions controls. I remember when we used to have to take our cars into the station before you get your tabs, you know, to get the emissions checked to make sure that it was good. Who was it? Jesse that got rid of that for us? I think it was Jesse.
I believe it was. Yeah.
You know, and maybe electric cars have had a little bit to do with this as well. But just being outside, being on the road now, when I started riding motorcycles in, mid to late 90s. Even back then, it was still like the roads, it just smelled awful. And it was like, and I have asthma, so I'd be coughing up a lung and, you know, you get behind the wrong car. And that just doesn't seem to happen at all today. Like,
it's very rare.
Once, you know, like once a month, you'll see a car that's like, oh, that guy's got a problem, like spewing black smoke out of his back end. And it's just an because I love driving. I really do love driving and riding my motorcycle. And it's one of those things that I've noticed a lot, like roads are safer, cleaner, and they smell a lot better than they ever did. I don't know. How did I get down this path, Peter? I feel like I was trying to make a point about alternative fuels.
I think you were talking about some alternative fuels and why we're moving away from fossil fuels, right? The big reasons that we're moving away from it is part of it is pollution, right? It doesn't burn completely and turn into H2O and, you know, some other innocuous materials. It turns into sort of carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, and water and other things. And, you know, I think if you told me that tomorrow we're going to capture everything coming out of a car exhaust and we're going to convert it into drinking water. And we've found a formula that did that. I'm totally making this up, Ian, before you're like, wait, what have you heard?
What's going on?
But I think if we did find that, I think it would be a lot harder conversation, right? It would be like, well, we don't really need electric cars because we produce drinking water with our cars now. And it's fabulous. I think that's one of the benefits and one of the hidden benefits that you're talking about, Chad, is that electric cars don't have a smell. Right. I mean, maybe they have a new car smell, but they don't have a burning fuel smell. There's no, I just started my van up and I can tell because it's in the garage smell.
You don't
right?
even think they have an exhaust pipe, do they?
No.
No. Okay. Yeah. No. So I was just thinking about that right now. I haven't seen them with an exhaust pipe. Not like they need one anyways, but.
It would be cool if they smelled like the old racetracks, the electric racetracks that we had as a kid.
Yeah.
You use it enough and it smells like ozone almost.
Little
right?
ozone. Yeah.
Yeah. That'd be kind of neat if they did that.
I know. So one thing about, I was talking earlier about how like I love the sports fan and the sound that the car makes.
Yeah.
And I think it's a Challenger. I believe it's a Challenger, and they are going electric. And they on the electric model that they have a sound in there that makes it roll like a
right.
like a fuel based car.
They recorded the real car and they play it back for you when you drive.
Yeah. Yeah, and they have it synced.
Do that too.
They have it synced where, you know, when you hit the accelerator, it makes that noise. Now, clearly, it's not organic noise because, you know, they have it in a way that maybe it's probably like a sound or a speaker. And they got a little bit of pushback from the fans saying, oh, that's not real. But I think that's also another solution, especially for the car fanatics who still want to have that roaring experience, that engine feel. It may not be the real sound, but I think, to me, I thought it was a very smart idea.
I agree with that. You know, and that it does bring a lot of that tactile feel to driving. I mean, Chad, you talked about loving of driving. I love driving. You go out on a country road and you find maybe a secluded spot and you open it up a little bit and have a little fun. And it just wouldn't be the same if it was just pushing a button and going faster, but without anything but a little bit more wind noise, right?
Yeah, that's... I have a video of, so in Vegas, this is more than 10 years ago, I rented that Ferrari.
Right.
And I was able to do just that. We went to this kind of what because I don't know Nevada at all. But we went to this, what looked like a quiet part of the desert. And I did get to open it up. And there's a video my wife took of me where just pointed at my face. And boy, that it's fun.
Like, smiling like a 10-year-old boy with his first bike, God. Right?
Yeah, it is a blast.
And your motorcycle is another one of those that has more of a tactile experience, right? Because it's not an electric motorcycle. It's not a what we'll call muffled, silenced motorcycle. Being honest, I believe you can tell that you're driving a motorcycle.
Have you seen or heard mine?
I've seen it. I'm trying to remember how Harley-Davidson it is. Compared to some of the others,
it's a little different, but yeah, I mean, we took specific steps to make it a little bit louder than it has any business being,
right?
And
there's a reason for that, right?
Well, I mean, part of it, I just like the sound, and I know that there's a loud group of people that that poke fun at Harley guys for having loud motorcycles, and go ahead, have your fun, but also. For practical purposes, having it as loud as possible really does make people aware of your existence on the road.
Yep.
And is a wonderful defense mechanism against people just kind of absentmindedly sliding into your lane or whatever.
Right.
So,
right.
There is a practical purpose to that.
Oh, 100%.
And then there's, you know, just the primal dopey dude that loves, you know, the loud noise. I love that. And then when you're riding too, it's like you're talking about this tactile experience, especially on the motorcycle. Like it's not just the noise and the wind in your face, but you feel the entire bike throughout your body, right? Like vibrating and doing what it does. And that's it's fun.
It's part of the experience. It's part of the reason why people still buy them and still make them that way is because it's an enjoyable experience. It's probably partly nostalgia from when they used to be made that way without being able to make them quieter, but also just the experience, right? So we talked about natural gas. We didn't talk about GM making an electric car for the second time. And apparently they made one a while ago, right?
Yeah.
The EV1.
Is it the Hummer? The Hummer EV?
No. Before that, even. Yeah.
You're right.
The Hummer EV is a GM, right?
The Hummer EV is a, I think. Well, I can't remember if they split Hummer off again or not. What are you saying, Chad?
It is the GM EV1.
Yeah.
Produced from 96 to 99.
Don't see a lot of those on the road right now.
Was there a reason for that? I forgot what happened.
Well, I think they made a movie about it. And of course, we're talking about Who Killed the Electric Car. And I don't remember if it was a Michael Moore movie or somebody else. But there were certainly some people that were upset that they lost their cars. It was an experiment, and it sounds like it was an experiment that either worked too well or didn't work well enough, one way or the other. I don't know. I haven't seen the movie to know for sure which way they've chosen to take it. But, there was basically the gist of the story was you could not buy one of these cars. You could only lease them. And when the lease was up, GM took them back and took them back sometimes from people that were willing to pay, willing to do anything it was to keep that car that they had such a great experience. And then they crushed them all so that there would be none on the road. Probably the best press for that. But, that was sort of the first electric car made by a major manufacturer. And then they stopped after 3 years.
Yeah.
I have so many questions with that story. Why would you make a car and not sell it? But we're not going to get into that. But yeah, I'll look into that myself. But I have so many questions for sure.
Have you guys used some of the other, we're talking about transportation. Mm-hmm. Have you guys used any of the other options that we have locally? So, I mean, we're kind of lucky. I mean, yeah, we've got light rail. We've got buses. We've got if you're in the city, one of my favorites is the Lime scooters.
I've used those, yeah.
I think those are all kind of really cool. And Minneapolis is losing Uber and not yet, but we'll see.
Well,
we're losing Uber and Lyft.
We may lose them.
I think we're going to lose them for a month or two and then they'll come back. But those other options, I mean, obviously for urban travel, amazing, right?
I mean, I think that's one of the unusual things. I don't know, maybe Minnesota is weirdly special, because if you lived in New York City, the fact of you not owning a car would not be special or different or anything, right? There's a lot of people in New York that don't own a car, or mm-hmm. or couples that own one car and split it between the two. East Coast, share a car. You only need, walk everywhere, walk for your groceries, walk for everything. Minnesota. And part of that is Minneapolis not being very dense and the suburbs being even less so. But, I certainly use the light rail when I can for things when I'm going downtown. I think if I work downtown, I would take it every day. And I think the scooters are probably getting close to solving the last mile problem that light rail presents, right? Like everything's great until you got to get that last mile to your house or a few miles to your house.
So I've got a fun Lime scooter story. At my last company, we were about 12 people at the time, located in Northeast Minneapolis, right? I organized an event. I bought Twins tickets. We were going to a Twins game.
Yep.
And I'm like, hey, how about if we all parked at the office Northeast, right? So Broadway and Central, kind of that area. I'll go around and pick up Lime scooters. So we'll have, 12 Lime scooters in the parking lot. And so I did that. Me and my buddy went around town in my truck. We loaded the back up with all the Lime scooters we could find.
Right.
What we didn't know, though, is if you pick one up and you move it, it's got GPS, it starts making an alarm sound, right?
Like it gets unhappy about that, huh?
And so, whatever, we're like, all right, well, we just have to.
It's fine. They'll stop eventually, right?
And they did. I'm in my truck. My buddy's next to me. I've got a bed full of Lime scooters.
What could go wrong?
And they're all 12 of them are going beep, 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 beep. Like, it's just loud and obnoxious. And I get to a stoplight and a Minneapolis cop pulls up next to me and rolls down his window. And he's like, everything all right over there? I'm like, don't worry about it, man. We hate those things. I'm like, seriously? Like, I could be committing a crime right now. And I think technically I might have been.
I don't think at that point you had, but you were certainly could have been on your way.
Yeah.
I mean, I think, yeah, I mean, we were on our way to being criminals. Good intent, right? Like we're going to bring them to the shot and we're going to all lime scooter to the Twins game. And we did make it work. It was an absolute blast, right? Going just those 2 miles from just northeast. 12
people all on scooters scooting along.
Dude, it's so cool. It is so much fun. And it's not just like practical. It's an actual fun way to get around town.
Right.
Insanely dangerous, but kind of fun. And so I think like little solutions like that are actually kind of cool, right? Like Minneapolis has, we've got our Lime Scooter program or the Bird, or I don't even know which ones are in
available right anymore. Now. Yep.
It seems like they change vendors every year.
Yep.
But we've got that, and we've got our nice ride, the bikes, right, that you can use.
Yep.
And,
do you remember Zipcar?
I do remember Zipcar.
Yeah. It was an experiment.
It was Zipcar. I was in a commercial for those. Long story. Awesome. We don't have to go into that. Yeah, there was Zipcar. There's all sorts of like nobody's stopped trying to come up with new ways to get people around.
To speak on that, you know, how people are coming up with new ways to get people around. And I don't know how you guys feel about this, but I wanted to try it when I go to California, is the fully autonomous vehicles, right? You go in there and there's no driver in there, and it's taking you from point A to point B. Now, they're also part of electric cars. I think all of them are electric anyway, but I think it's another level of electric cars. Would you guys feel safe in those? I want to give it a try, but, you know, I guess for me, from your generation, would you feel safe going into a car, no driver, get from point A to point B?
I feel just as safe in one of those as riding with my 15-year-old the very first time we took her out driving around. You know, you've got an inexperienced driver who's going to make some mistakes, but as long as everybody stays calm, you're probably going to get there without getting into an accident.
Those things those are great for places like California and dry climate or warmer climates, but if I'm remembering right, when there's snow on the ground, the entire tech stack falls apart, right? So self-driving cars in the winter in Minnesota, you know, when you can't, you know, unless we improve GPS GPS is, it can locate you within 6 inches?
Right.
But I think, what is it? It's a government thing where they make it so that the closest you can identify something is within 20 feet or something.
Yeah. I think it's a little bit closer than that, but they're doing surveying with GPS now, not with eyesight and little sighter is called.
That's what I'm getting at, is these self-driving cars. If we can use GPS as its, you know, as its guide and not, you know, lane identification and everything else.
Well, that has a snowstorm problem too, but yeah.
I mean, it's got the ice and the traction issue, but it doesn't have the identify my position on the street, you know, all that. So I don't know. I mean, I think one of the coolest advances that I've seen is, or one of the coolest ideas that I've seen talked about is the idea of cars talking to each other.
That's my favorite.
And like actually without us knowing, right? Like other cars on the road communicating with each other and literally like preventing, making accidents almost impossible, right? And
my favorite ideal, my favorite concept when I was commuting was I drive my car onto 494, I get behind somebody, my car talks to them, they agree that somebody's going to be in charge, and we drive around the cities until I decide like, oh, your exit's in 1 mile, go ahead and, you know, leave the car train when you're ready. I think that would just be a super easy, I mean, cars communicating to each other. Hey, we're going in a straight line. We're turning a little bit. All of that would be amazing. I think you're talking about sort of super communication, where almost air traffic control level of communication, right? Where, you know, I know where Ian's car and Ian's car knows where your car is and your motorcycle is, and we're looking out for each other, and we can see when our paths are going to connect and not make them connect in an uncomfortable metal crunching fashion, right?
Yeah. And it's the way it's described to me as a guy that likes computers and technology is it's like a UDP protocol for cars, where you're like, you're just sending out a signal saying,
right, I'm here.
Know, here's my speed, here's my direction, here's, you know, all the aspects of what I'm doing, and maybe even potentially here's what route we have plugged into this map. And then, you know, if you could actually broadcast that out somehow and all the other cars on the road can understand that. I mean, holy smokes, if you could broadcast your route out to other cars and other people and have everybody adapt and maybe use some sort of, you know, logic to help eliminate congestion on roads so that you don't have to all use the same road. You know, like if I knew where right now, so for me, the meat raffle is in 3 hours.
Right.
If I knew that everybody was going to get on 610 to 94 to Minneapolis right now, I'd take a different route.
Yeah.
We're kind of there with Google Maps and Apple Maps and everything else where they can kind of say in real time, here's the.
They do talk to the mothership, but not necessarily real time to each other, right?
Yeah. Yeah, that'd be pretty slick. But I don't know. Still seems like science fiction.
Yeah, I guess I don't particularly see the as of now, because if other cars or drivers maybe know where I'm going, apart from the whole traffic thing, the routes that are occupied with less traffic, which is probably already a solution in the Google Maps, I don't see the point. Personally, at least, I'm like, okay, why would my car need to communicate with you? I'm trying to get there safe. Whether you know about it or not, that's where I'm trying to go. So I don't see a practical value of it as of now. It probably is, but I don't know. I feel like it's one of those features. You know, like how you have a phone and has so many features, but you don't need all the features? Yeah. I feel like it's kind of one of those things.
Maybe.
I don't know.
I just looked it up. So it's GM calls it the V2V system, the vehicle-to-vehicle system, where you can broadcast up to a quarter mile to other cars. And it actually... Yeah, it communicates your direction, your speed.
What it needs to be telling us is how far the police is, or if the police is behind me. That's what I need to know. That's exactly what I need to know.
That's the sports car problem right there.
There's a different. Yeah,
I need
there's
to a know different how device far, device. How close, which street, under which bridge. That's what I want to know.
I mean, there's the other side of the coin, right? Once all the cars talk to each other, you should be able to drive a lot faster, right? Because speed kills, but speed plus computers might not.
And I think I've seen that with even with Google Maps. I think sometimes it would tell you like there's either like a police watch. I don't know if you've gotten those, like a speed trap or something like that. I don't know how effective they are, but you know, I don't mind the heads up. That's what I'm going to say. I don't mind the heads up.
So sort of to close in on another future technology that we talked about, we talked about Hyperloop and some of the things that Elon has talked about with Hyperloop. I think if it gets to the point where it's implemented, and how do you see that working, Ian?
Well, it's Hyperloop. It also falls down in line with zero emissions because it's going to be completely green. It's something that has been, you know, brought up by Elon Musk since 2013, and we've seen some countries like India, Italy, China, Japan, Dubai, kind of like in the first stages of implementing, you know, this type of technology. The biggest issue that comes with it is definitely the cost. The cost just ramps way up to a point where we've seen companies pull out of such investments because they don't see how maybe they're able to get their money back. It really, I haven't seen any, let's say, government that has implemented it. A lot of them is, you know, own maybe technological companies that are trying to, you know, implement this type of technology.
So can you describe the technology behind it? What's the whole system here?
Yeah, it's basically magnetic levitation. So it's going to be like magnets within the rail and the train itself. And then when it's, I would say, turned on, there's going to be that little bit of space between the rail. And this helps with no friction. So basically, it's like the tube is flying because it's pretty much in the air. And in these tunnels, the Hyperloop tunnels, they have machines like vacuum pumps that, you know, suck the air out of the tunnels. Just because I don't know, if you're in your car and you're driving and you put your hand out, you're probably going to feel the air push it back. So there's
a lot of wind resistance there.
Yeah. So what these tunnels are going to be, they're going to be like a vacuum whereby the air resistance is taken out of the transportation model, making them go very fast to speeds up to 750 miles per hour. Now that's very fast. To give you a little bit of perspective, an average commercial airline travels at about 600 or 500 miles per hour. So 750 is up there, you know, in terms of
that's
speed.
That's more than that.
Definitely. So it could be a challenger for air transportation. But again, the target for these Hyperloops are more within cities that are about maybe 600, 500, 700 miles. Anything above 1,000 miles, then the cost just doesn't align well because you're better offline there than actually taking a Hyperloop. But I think it's an interesting technology just because we've seen a lot of, especially through the population growth, you see a lot of transportation between cities. Let's say if you had to take a Hyperloop from Minneapolis to St. Paul, which is our biggest cities here in the Twin Cities area, probably take you maybe 5 minutes instead of maybe 25 or 20 minute ride. So I think from that perspective, it's something that's going to be implemented a little bit slow because the cost is really up there. And we're finding it's hard for companies to kind of like justify that. But from a practical perspective, it does work because we've seen even, I think the first human test ride was in 2020. And that worked fine. Safety was great. So
it didn't explode.
But yeah, it didn't explode, you know. So but I think it's a fun concept. I would love to see it or even try it out. But as you know, there's a lot of things before these things are really pushed out to the public and people really utilize them. Yeah.
All right. So, Chad, any parting thoughts on our future transportation?
I don't know, man. I think it's gosh darn it. I don't really.
No parting thoughts.
Don't take my motorcycle away from me. That's it.
Okay.
That's the one thing that I'm not super worried about, but you know, you hear like whispers of like in California, they're going to say, not only are they going to ban the sale of electric vehicles, but they're going to, ban, you know, internal combustion engine at a certain point.
Right.
And that certain point is probably past my lifetime, so I shouldn't probably care.
Yeah.
And actually it might be a reason to get excited, right? Because if they actually ban combustion engines in California and don't in Minnesota, there's going to be the opportunity to buy a lot of really cool, really cheap cars.
There you go. From big tourism.
So
awesome. Ian, how about you? Parting thoughts?
Parting thoughts. I think we're still in the early stages of electric vehicles or, you know, self-autonomous vehicles. And I think, you know, humanity is kind of looking for the next big thing. I think that's, as you know, when you were curious about that, what's the next big thing? It could be that, it could not be that. But I'm interested to know where the direction that's going to go. You know, if this is, I think electric cars commercially, as in like Tesla, I don't know how long Tesla's been here before, but I think moving forward, we're going to see huge change in terms of models, styles of the vehicles, and comfortability, and if autonomous can get to the level that we wanted to get to. So I guess my debating thoughts, I'm thinking maybe when I'm older and have my grandkids, you know, be like, hey, dad, let's just go somewhere and nobody has to drive, you know, which is,
there you go.
You know, yeah, stuff like that. So I'm excited for that journey. And as a car fanatic, I can't tell what technology is going to take us, but I'm very interested in that too, and to see that journey for them as well.
All right. My parting thought is I think we're going to have four-wheeled vehicles for probably at least 100 years until who knows what'll take their place. But those tires, those wheels, everything just works pretty darn well so far. So that's my thought. Thank you, gentlemen. Appreciate your time. And I think it's time to say goodbye, everybody.
See you guys.
Bye. See you.
Solution Design Group is a digital product consultancy in Minneapolis. Check us out on the web at solutiondesign.com or look for us on Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, and Instagram at Solution Design Group.